We are all going to work out and plan, probably off camera, how to connect all of our bases and have one large, cohesive, first ever, I believe, Giga base.
Hi, I'm ThaMango, and today we're going to be starting a pretty huge project. Seeing as you all really liked the Season 9 base transformation videos, I decided to take things a bit further. And over the next month, I'm going to be transforming and finishing the entire Boatem area from Season 8 of HermitCraft. We're going to be transforming Grian, Pell, Impulse, Scar, and Mumbo's mega bases, as well as their starter homes and any other builds in the area. This is going to be an insane series, so please make sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on the next episodes. Anyway, we've got a load of work to get done, so let's begin. I thought that the best place to begin this series would be with Grian's starter base. I'm going to be doing one hermit per episode, so we can fully dedicate an episode to each his amazing builds. There will probably be some smaller builds of Grian's that I don't get to in this episode though, as he probably made the most structures around Boatem out of any of the hermits. However, I'll just do anything left over in a separate Hermits video when I have some free time. Grian's mega base, the Midnight Alley, is definitely going to be the main focus of this episode, but working on some of Grian's smaller bases first was a good way to warm up and get ready for the bigger builds. For a starter base, there really wasn't much to update or transform, so I just went around the build and added in a few smaller details, and then added a load of vines and leaves growing around the base, like it had been abandoned. Seeing as this is Grian's old and unused base, I thought it'd be best to give it a very rundown look, making it clear that it hadn't been used in a very long time. All around the area, I surrounded the house with loads of farms. The plan here is that we can eventually work to turn the central area of Boatem into a larger village, with plenty of farms and other houses for shops to be placed in, all positioned around the Boatem pole. I'm not entirely sure though, make sure to leave a comment on what you would put in this area. The best thing about this series is that I can read your comments for suggestions before beginning each new episode, so this is as much my project as it is yours. If you notice any issues or have any ideas for Boatem, you can always comment about them and I'll make sure to incorporate whatever I can. As you can see here, I surrounded all of the farms with a very rustic looking wooden wall, using a mix of logs, stairs and slabs to make it look like the wall had started decaying. One detail I really like to add to builds, which you'll probably see me incorporate quite a lot, is strips of stairs. It helps to add a slight indent into the wall to add some extra depth, without being too overbearing. An issue I had when editing this house was trying to expand on it without over-detailing. I definitely think I was right on the line between detailed and over-detailed, but luckily, because the house is meant to look abandoned and slightly messy, I think I managed to get away with it. That's subjective of course, so you might hate it. I fixed up the pathway into the house and then added some further hanging leaves. I used sponge as a placeholder hanging down from the leaves, which I later switched to drip leaves as they make for very realistic looking vines. On top of this, I surrounded the front area with loads of plants, mostly using purple based flowers like alliums and lilacs. And with that, the exterior of the house was finished. While I had a good idea of the farms I wanted to make around it, I decided to focus on building a few more of them in the surrounding area, before moving on to the interior of the house. I used the pathways which had already been marked out around Boatem, surrounding them with azalea leaves, and filling in some of the fields in between the pathways with a mix of farms and flowers. I also added in a couple of custom trees to fit the area. Before this project, I'd never actually built a tree in this style before, and so it was a fun first try. I really love how they came together. I mostly used Scar's trees in his base for inspiration, as he's insanely good at making trees, which I didn't fully realise until seeing them in-game for myself. The most requested build people have been wanting me to transform is Scarland, which I don't feel comfortable doing without his permission, seeing as it's such an important build for him. So being able to work on one of his different bases should hopefully be close enough. I'll probably be working on his build next episode because I'm really, really excited to work on it. After finishing the main decorations, I added in a couple of benches around the area, as well as some decorative crates using beehives and some dirt around the edges of the paths to make them look a bit more used. As I mentioned before, we'll certainly expand on this area in a future episode, but for now, this is a really good start. And now, moving on to the interior of Grian's base, I didn't realise just how destroyed it had been. I fixed up all of the broken areas though, and added in some smaller details to tie the build together. I also then added the final, most important detail to make it into a Grian base. And with that, the starter base had been transformed. Before we get to the Midnight Alley, I wanted to quickly work on transforming the Diamond Sand Timers. You might not even remember these bad boys, but Grian created these sand timers back in his 16th episode of Series 8, so all of the Boatem Hermits could show off their riches and compete to get the most diamonds. I decided to move these timers to a further back area of the town, located by the ocean. I wanted to make them look like they were on a dock, so I created a large wooden platform to place them all on. I built up the edges and connected the area to the land with a small pathway. On top of the timers, I fixed up the floating lettering, which says Boatem Inc., to no longer be floating. I simply added a backboard to the text and then created some supports along either edge which hold it up. I then also switched from having a letter representing each hermit's name to instead just using their skulls, as it looked a lot cleaner. For the floor of the area, I experimented with a few colours of glass, but ended up going for brown as it fit the wooden flooring very well. I edited the underground area of the timers and then built up a few stacks of diamonds in each of them, just to show how they'd look when used. Finally, I connected the area to the main pathway, and that was that. Now we can finally move on to the Midnight Alley. Kind of. I was a bit lost on how to transform the Midnight Alley, as it's such a well-made and detailed build. The conclusion I came to though was that I can make it both longer and taller to make it even more immersive. My plan is to make some slight changes to the current houses while also adding in a bunch of new ones and some new areas. I also have a cool surprise which I'll be adding on top of the Gringotts bank after I've adjusted the exterior. The first thing I had to do though in order to make this was adjust for terrain. I made the mountain that the alley is located inside of about 30 blocks taller, and I also surprisingly decided to add a back to the terrain, even though it's Grian's base. Hopefully this doesn't make it too unrealistic. As you can see, I had to drain the ocean near the mountain while working on it, but don't worry, I'll fix the water back up when I'm done. I kept the terrain pretty simplistic, with some very large mountains on top. I'll probably have to adjust these though in the future once I begin work on Scar's sky base on top of the mountains. For now though, I just painted them pretty quickly before moving on to painting the rest of the cliff that they sit on. I came up with a couple more unique tree designs. I only made three this time, as I could copy and paste these designs around the rest of the terrain, to save me from having to make about 30 unique designs. I added some red mushrooms onto the trees just to make them look a bit more magical and to fit the theme of the alley. Once all the trees were pasted down, I filled back in the water in the ocean and was ready to begin working on the inside of the mountain. I was a bit lost on how to transform the Midnight Alley, as it's such a well-made and detailed build. The first thing to do was move the end section of the alley to be further away. And so I moved this chunk with the bank and a couple of houses back and down by a few blocks. I then patched up the pathway to connect everything once again. I'll work on detailing the path and shaping it a bit better later on. Now was probably the most difficult part of the entire build so far. I had to work on adding houses in the gaps to connect the alley back up. This was difficult though, because if I made them too unique in style from the rest of the area, they would look extremely out of place and stand out like a sore thumb. I tried to use block palettes that Grian had already used in the alley, while mixing in one or two unique block palettes. I also took notes from the previous houses, noticing that they all had a lot of windows and storefronts, which I tried my best to incorporate into these new houses. This house right here is a large pub, and it's probably one of my favourite designs. I love how it came together and spent about an hour making this one house. I added this large window at the top with a dining room behind it, which you can view while walking past, which adds a load of character to the building. and really makes it feel lived in. I also added an alleyway to split up the houses a little bit more. On the other side of the path, I added in a large bookstore with a spired roof. In the middle of it, I added in a large window where you can see loads of floating enchanted books behind it, which I made using invisible item frames. As you'll see in a minute, the interior for this building looks just as cool. Next to it, I made this honey store, which I built using loads of beehives to fit the theme of the store. As you can see, there's an arch under the building which leads nowhere. We'll be adding something really cool there later on, so make sure to remember this. The last houses I added were these two really small houses, which fit very snugly into the remaining space. With the houses done, I fixed up the pathway, adding in a bit more shaping and a lot of decorations, continuing the theming that Grian had added in before I destroyed the pathway. I also added in some hanging decorations out the front of some of the buildings I just made, like a store sign and a hanging box filled with a bee, which I thought looked especially magical. After this, I went back and made some edits to the older houses that Grian made. They already looked pretty perfect, so I didn't change much, but I felt I had to at least try to put my own spin on the build a little bit, seeing as that's the whole point of this series. The main thing I tried to do was breathe as much character into the build as possible, adding in a load of mobs all over the map to create as much kinetic energy as possible, especially as that was Grian's original goal. He originally added in a lot of mobs which unfortunately despawned when I converted the world, but I added all of those back and even more. I also worked on adjusting some of the shaping of some buildings very slightly, and added a tiny bit more colour onto some buildings using concrete powder, and a lot of mushrooms scattered around. Overall, you can't notice much of a difference, but that was the goal after all. Next up, I moved on to interiors. I made interiors for almost all of the houses, leaving a few as just facades, as Grian mentioned he wanted to build farms behind a couple of them, so I left room for that. The store I turned into a Neverite armor store, which works as a sort of magical Never blacksmith. I then moved on to the library's interior, which I really spent a while working on. I made a singular level design and then stacked it downwards, using black glass at the bottom to make it look endless. Once that was done, I filled in the area with loads of floating books, which look like they're magically moving around. I seriously love how this room came together. I won't show you all of the interiors, but here's another one of my favourites which I created for the pub. It looks extremely cosy and the grand fireplace at the end of the room fits it perfectly. And with that all done, now we get to move on to Gringotts Bank. Unlike the rest of the alley, I'm going to make quite a few edits to this building. I started by switching up some of the blocks used, like changing the crooked pillars to be quartz pillars instead of just plain quartz blocks. I edited the main windows quite a bit, switching the border around them from dark oak wood to deep slate tiles instead, as I thought it'd blend nicer with the quartz and looked a bit more secure, which is always ideal for a bank. I then went and made the building a bit taller, extending all of the layers of calcite between each floor to be two blocks thick rather than one. This would make the building a bit grander, and help to make room to add some banners out the front, which say Gringotts Bank, or just Gringot because I couldn't fit the rest, but it still looks very cool. I then reworked the top of the building, making it slightly thicker than before. I redid the dome, making it slightly less rounded like a lot of the concept arts I saw online for Gringotts Bank. For the bottom floor of the bank, I removed all windows to once again fit some concept art, and also because most banks probably wouldn't have windows that low down, just to help keep things secure. As for the remaining windows on the higher levels, I adjusted the blocks used to make them fit in more with the edited larger windows, and then I edited the shaping of the top area of the bank to make it slant out a bit more, rather than inwards. You probably already know what the surprise on top of the bank is because of the thumbnail, but I added on this huge dragon which my friend Bobgeam designed, which sits perfectly on top of the bank. I then added some fire breathing out of its mouth to make it look even more scary. I'm extremely happy with how the bank came together, but now let's move on to the interior. My goal here is to make the inside look very grand, like a rich banking hall. I started with this small pre-room, which is like a mini lobby which joins to the main hallway. I used raw copper as pillars throughout the building, which work perfectly as a marble alternative. I didn't even know this block existed until I was scrolling through the creative inventory, trying to find a good block to use. I created these large blacked out windows framed by pillars. In front of each of these windows would be a small desk, with each having a goblin sat at it, or in this case, a villager. This whole room was very heavily inspired by the queue for Escape from Gringotts at Universal Studios, which lets you actually walk through the bank. At the back of the hall, I added in a huge G. You can probably guess why. My favourite part of the whole bank is these unique chandelier designs that I came up with, using amethysts. While they're a bit bulky, I still really like how they look. To finish up the room, I switched the floor to various transparent blocks, like ice and glass. And then I flipped the room underneath itself to make the floor look so shiny that it's transparent. This really helped to tie the room together and gives it a very grand feel, despite it being pretty small. Once the villagers were added in, the bank was officially finished. Even though it's one of the last things we're doing, the most important part of this build is the terrain, as it'll really help to tie the whole build together. I created spheres of stone all around the area and then smoothed it out to make a large cavern. Grian's original plan for the ceiling of the cave was to have lots of plants and occasional skylights with stars outside, instead of just having the entire ceiling being stars. I really wanted to do my best to bring this original vision to life. I created four holes for lights, with the largest being directly on top of the bank. I filled these in with lots of layers of end rods and black glass to give the same star effect that Grian originally used. It seriously looked amazing and like a real night sky. With the stars in place, I created these huge spikes of lapis blocks. Don't worry though, these are just placeholders, which I switched to be light sources, to help create seemingly organic light shining downwards into the cave. I did this for anywhere where there was an opening, and then dimmed the lights to look a bit more natural, and then removed almost all of the torches and lanterns from the houses on the streets, to help really let the natural lighting show. I then created some vines hanging down from the ceiling, and also added in a couple of trees. Finally, I created the small waterfall coming down from the side of the cave, seeing as it's one of the things Grian specifically mentioned he wanted to add. And that was it for the cave. Now you might not remember this area as it wasn't mentioned much, but this alleyway takes you down to Eerie Alley. This is actually an area that Scar made rather than Grian. Inside, I just once again made some very minor edits to the buildings, as well as adding in some bat spawners under some hidden grey carpets to help flood the area with spooky bats. I also quickly fixed up the sky. At the end of the alley is this large iron door. I decided to open it up and build this small boss fight looking room inside. In this room, one of the most scary creatures in Boatem would be kept locked away to keep the area safe, and just because I didn't know what else to do with it. That creature is Treza. Grian built this with Pell's help in an earlier episode to prank Mumbo, and as it looks kind of scary but also magical, I thought it would fit perfectly in this area of the base, and so I moved it. Finally, I could move on to finishing the entrance of the cavern, adding in a bunch more rocks and vegetation, before moving on to the final thing we have to build today, an update to the G-Train. For the train, I decided it would be cooler and fit in better if it was raised above the ground, on a big stone bridge similar to the one seen in Harry Potter. To do this, I just cleared out the area while making a copy of the train to add back in later, and I then raised a section of the track to be about 20 blocks off the ground. Once it was in place, I began working on this cool arch design, using a mixture of stone-based as well as deep slate blocks. I could then copy this design multiple times to create a longer section of track. For now, it just ends near Pell's base, but I want to work on making it flow more smoothly into the terrain once I get to editing Pell's base. All around the base of the bridge, I added in some plants, and I then worked on adding a slight gradient to the bridge's block palette. The track will obviously need the terrain on it at some point, as it's used as Grian's shopping area for the season. I decided it would be cool to make a station which connects to the Midnight Alley. And so I built this station, which is loosely inspired by a London train station, using a brick-based block pallet. You'll be able to access it by either flying through the train tunnel on an elytra, or by taking the stairs up, which we'll build in a second. Once the tunnel was all finished, I added back in the train, which perfectly fits into the station. You'd now be able to do all of your important block shopping while inside of a train station, which is pretty cool. Finally, as I mentioned, I connected up the Midnight Alley to the train station via a long staircase. And that was me finished with transforming Grian's Boatem bases. There are a couple more builds he created in the area, but I plan to do those in other episodes where I'm working on the areas around them a bit more. With that being said, I'm really happy with how this came together. I spent about 100 hours on this video, so I'd really appreciate it if we could hit 1,000 likes. If we manage to reach it, I'll post part 2 with Scar's base. Thank you so much for watching.